Hello, my name is Kelly Simmons. I am a music education coordinator at Canada's National Arts Centre. Welcome to Ottawa, Ontario. This is part three of a four-part series on Grieg's Holberg Suite for strings. In this third part, you will get tips from Julia McLean, assistant principal cello of the NEC Orchestra, on a number of subjects from dynamics to pizzicato in the cello part of the Holberg Suite.
Hello, my name is Julia McLean. I am the assistant principal cellist of the National Arts Centre Orchestra, and I am pleased to welcome you to my home in Wakefield, Quebec this afternoon. This is the third video in a four-part series covering the string parts of Grieg's Holberg Suite. And today I was gonna just go over some of the ways that I would practice this first movement, some different colors, some nice long crescendos, different ways of making accents, pizzicato. So hope you enjoy. All right, so the first thing that I thought we could look at is the first crescendo in the cello part of the first movement. So these are three bars leading up to letter A. So we've started with our big fortissimo piano. We're sitting on this piano note for a few bars. And then we have this line. And it's an exciting, you know, from the beginning of that line where it's written crescendo, we already feel that this cadence is leading to a big moment, to a big downbeat. And so it's, I find, pretty easy to get too loud too soon. So the first thing I would do is take out the accents and just see how I can grade that crescendo. So I'll just start from the pickup. And just to make sure that each note I'm playing is getting louder than the previous one, and that I haven't reached a point where I'm stuck and I'm staying at the same level, because then we actually lose the excitement. Actually, recording is a great way to check, you know, even on your iPhone, a little voice memo. It's a really easy and fast way to listen back to yourself, and you'll hear right away, oh, was that a smooth crescendo, a consistent crescendo? And so then I'll add the accents. And there are many different ways of producing an accent. In this case, it's a bow impulse, but I also like to make sure that my left hand is active in these accents. And so that time I didn't quite like my dotted half note. I thought my sound kind of died there. So I want to make sure that I can sustain through that, keep the crescendo going. And also noticing that the downbeat, even though it's a forte piano, the downbeat of A does not have an accent. So I'm going to try to make that feel like an arrival, even though it doesn't have that sharp accent of the other notes. Last time, we can do this all day, can't we? The next thing I want to look at is just the next bar at A. So suddenly we have pianissimo, we have a very long bow, but we still have an accent on this F sharp. And so this is going to be a very different kind of accent. I'm not going to use much bow speed or impulse. I'm going to try to use mostly left hand and almost more of a tenuto feeling, just to kind of weight in the bow. So we're coming out of this forte piano that we've arrived at. Lots of things to think about here. There are those first two accents, and then we have a più piano, which means more quiet. So even though we've already been playing a beautiful pianissimo, we need to find even a level lower. So this is tricky because you want that pianissimo at A to be super soft, but you do have to leave yourself room to go a little bit further. I'm not sure I did that the last time. And then we have a crescendo molto over two bars and we're on one bow. So when we get to that B, we really need to save the bow so that we have as much bow towards the last bar to make a really big crescendo before the forte staccato notes, quarter notes. And then one last detail that I really like is the sforzando on the last note before the repeat. So that's going to give us a really nice rhythm going back, a really nice 5-1 back to the repeat or to the next section. So let's just break this down a little bit, these bow accents, or tenuto and vibrato accents. Softer. Save the bow. Crescendo. A lot to do. You can, you know, practice two bars there and the next two bars. But I find that this first phrase is really fun because we go from, you know, big accents to very soft, beautiful playing. And then right back, it's like the cloud that came over just kind of goes away right away. So I find that really enjoyable to practice. I want to jump ahead to just after B. Six bars after B, where we have a pizzicato line in the cello part. So pizzicato is normally very difficult to have come across. It's easier to do the pizzicato sort of over the fingerboard here. The closer we go to the bridge, the clearer the sound will be. And we have to know that even if it sounds metallic and a little, just kind of not so pretty under our ear, that a pizzicato, as it's traveling out to the rest of the orchestra and to the audience, is going to lose that grainy sound and just become clear. So you want to have your finger sort of at the end of the fingerboard. And then you can add a little bit of vibrato to round it out and have it ring. Feels kind of like a liveliness in the left hand. As opposed to if you're doing it here, I don't know how it comes across on the videos and the screens, but in a hall or in a live music situation, don't we miss those? Pitching up here is not going to carry. So I want to look at letter C here, which has this super lively, fun rhythm. But it's a little bit tricky for the bow to get organized. So the first thing I would do is play just the quarter notes without, and I would leave out the 16th notes. That would look something like this. I can do that again and pay close attention to the accents, really noticing where there are accents and where there are not accents. So, just the quarter notes. Once I have that pattern of the accents, I'm going to start adding the little notes and telling myself that they're a very small motion that shouldn't get in the way of this larger feeling that I've learned in my arm now. So One of the things that I find difficult is that as I'm telling myself to let go of some of the accents, then I notice I'm getting quieter, and I notice that right when I see in the music it's written sempre fortissimo, so to keep up the fortissimo. So I have to work to keep the sound going even though I am doing fewer accents. So I'll try that one more time. Getting there. There's always more work to do. And I want to look at one final accent and crescendo moment with you, which is at the very end. So I'm starting on the fortissimo, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bars before the end. And it's not a crescendo is not written, but there's a writ, which really makes us feel like this is building to the very end. So even though we're already loud, the writ is through the fact that we are slowing down, we're going to try to continue to build the tension. So what I'm going to do is make sure that I'm using more and more bow with every note, with every accent. So I'm going to try that one more time and make sure I felt that some of my up bows were not as accented as my down bow. So I'm going to try to even those out, and I'm going to be even more specific about each note, starting in the second bar of that where the writ is written, each note having more and more bow so that I'm building the tension. I think that's getting there. This is a really interesting movement with these different ways of using the accents, the left hand sort of softer accents and the more melodic parts, and then these more robust ones that are kind of delineating the different rhythms.
In the next video, you will see Marjolaine Fournier talk about the double bass in Grieg's Holberg Suite. We would love to hear from you. Please send us your feedback and questions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching and keep practicing.